Now we've discussed the theory for client and server communication. We will now apply our knowledge and skill to the static capture file that we've created, file 1, pcap.ng. You can open the file to follow along and complete the steps as I do, or you can watch first and then do it when you watch it again. So we just click on File, Open, and we find our file 1, pcap.ng. So once we open it, it will open up, and you see here, we start off with packets, and on the left column, you have the numbers, and then we've got all this ARP traffic. But before we get into that, what we want to do, we want to look at our DNS. Remember, DNS, domain name server, takes our name and converts it from human readable form to machine readable form, which of course is binary. So what we want to do is we want to go down here to where we find some DNS traffic, and we'll go through this several times, so you'll get to look at it quite often. So, and we'll show you quicker ways to do this. For now, we're learning the basics. So what we're going to do is we're going to look for a specific packet because I've researched this trace already. So now I come down here, and here's the packet I want, this 1093. So as you see here, we have www.udemy.com. That's the DNS query for the Udemy website. And in the middle window, you see here, we have a source port, which is greater than 1023. And we have a destination port, which is 53, which is what the domain name server or DNS resides on. This points to the fact that clients normally use a port greater than 1023, and the service is less than 1023. Next thing we want to look at is the DNS information itself. So we click to expand this section that is called the domain system query. And in the query, it has a question. And that question is exactly what you probably think that question is. It's www.udemy.com. So when we look at this question, we see www.udemy.com. That's the question going to the server. So what we want to do is we're going to actually look at the actual query. We have that, and we got what's called type A for address record, and class is an internet record. So now that we've looked at the query, what do you think we want to look for next? The response. So it's the very next packet, which makes it easy. So now when we look at the response, we see that the only difference is located at the bottom. There's the query, but in the response, we have this answer. And the answer comes out and gives us www.udemy.com is at this IP address. You can see here this 151.101.24.175. That is the IP address of the Udemy server. So now that we have that, that is actually replaced in our browser transparently to us, but it's replaced in our browser, and now it goes out and connects on that IP address to the server that's located there. Okay? Remember, the IP address is what the machine needs to get it to the correct location. So we return to our top window. We see right after the response, which created the machine readable form, we go into a series of connections to this port 80. Now we'll discuss what that is in the future, but right now, just understand that's a request to that web server to talk to me. And that's really what the main thing is. So now that we have this, we want to look at an example of ARP, the Address Resolution Protocol. Now ARP is local, so we'll not see the ARP for the Udemy server. But we have a number of ARP packets we can review. If we in our file locate packet number 3708, so we come down here, we'll page down, and we look for packet 3708. Again, we'll teach you a quicker way of doing this once we build your skill set. But right now, we're looking right there. And we see in packet 3708, the source MAC address is coming from a machine, and the destination address is representative of all these Fs. These Fs are the broadcast address. And you see, it's basically a question. Who has 192.168.0.7? Tell me. 192.168.0.1. So once you see this, you know that packet 3708 is the request. Well, where's the response? The response is here at packet number 3714. As you can see here, 192.168.0.7 is at MAC address in the hexadecimal again, CC3D821E514F. Now we have the physical address, and now that machine can receive data. This is the information for the packet ARP. So if we click on this, as you can see, the middle window now has address resolution protocol. And if you look here, there's the MAC address. So now it tells you the IP address and the target MAC address. Now we have all this information that we've analyzed just in a couple of simple clicks of and looking in the tool Wireshark. As we said, it's much easier to represent the IP address in hexadecimal. Because we go here, there is the target IP address in numbers, but rather than looking at it in binary, we have it here C0A800001. In this section, you have verified how client and a server communicates and how DNS and ARP network traffic look like in Wireshark. One important thing to note here is that the entire process we have discussed, ARP and DNS by default and in accordance with the protocol, do not have any authentication. So the source of the packet is trusted to be whom they say they are. This is one of the biggest reasons we have all the attacks and all the hacks and the things you hear about in the news today continues to be that the protocols all are based on what's called the principle of trust. Now, the newer ones that we started to add to and stuff like that is changing that. But the hackers today still can use this principle of trust to their advantage when they conduct their attacks. Next up, we will look at your first protocols. And this concludes our introduction into client-server communication analysis.